is why statistical methods must be used to evaluate most results in these disciplines. One of the overlooked implications of this fact is that valid relationships that are not exceptionally strong are likely not to reach conventional levels of statistical significance in a replication attempt simply as a result of sampling variability. A second cause of the failure of ESP experiments to replicate by conventional criteria is the fact that it is difficult, if not impossible, to precisely replicate the original methodology in all potentials in which we expect. For example, any independent replication attempt by definition involves a different experimenter, and, as we shall see later, there is evidence that different experimenters conducting the same ESP experiment frequently appear significantly different results. The ways in which different experimenters interact with their subjects is difficult to control, but likely has a profound effect on experimental outcomes in this area. We are only beginning to understand the situational variables that determine the success or failure of ESP experiments. Even if one concedes all of the above, the fact still remains that the repeatable ESP experiment does not exist. Any scientist who chooses to cite this fact as a reason for concluding that the existence of ESP has not been proven is on firm ground, at least in terms of scientific tradition. But why all the fuss over whether ESP has been proven? Proof behavior that is appropriate in mathematics and logic but not in empirical science. Cases that are based on probabilistic models when used probabilistic methods of analysis should restrict themselves to probabilistic conclusions. The proper question is not whether ESP has been proven but what. 70 John Palmer. Is this objective probability one conveniently attached to the validity of the ESP hypothesis? Unfortunately, such a judgment must be largely subjective, although there are certain objective factors that should enter into it. One factor that in my opinion should not enter into it is the so-called a priori probability of ESP. One often hears the argument that if ESP exists, it would violate other well-established laws of nature. This simply is not true. The ESP hypothesis proves with a set of observations put on the outside of those that serve as the database for evaluating other physical laws or theories. ESP in no way threatens the validity of currently accepted scientific laws with respect to the observations in which those laws were intended to apply. The only threat posed by parapsychology is the universality of those laws. Finally accepted by the majority of orthodox scientists, the preferred explanation of how you are assimilating the information on this page will have to deal with patterns of light processed by your physical sense organs and brain, not with ESP. A factor that should enter into the judgment is the massive evidence in support of the ESP hypothesis accumulated over the years by parapsychologists and others. First of all, while anecdotal reports of ESP experiences by laymen do not and should not carry the conviction of well-designed experiments, a substantial proportion of the population have reported ESP experiences that they found convincing, both in the United States, Greece, 1975, Palmer and Dennis, 1975, and elsewhere, Harrelson, Judgment Dottier, Radlarson, Lost Son, and Johnson, 1977. Furthermore, many such cases have been carefully documented, Burney et al., 1886-1970, Stevenson, 1970. The detail of correspondence between these experiences and the target events is often greater and the likelihood that the technical carrots are from repeatability in EST research, it would be equally erroneous to say that there is no repeatability at all, especially when one considers the results of attempts by experimenters to repeat their own results. Generally speaking, I would say that the level of repeatability is about what one would expect given a genuine public phenomenon. Extrasensory perception, research findings. 71. Subjects in a data report sampling error can change the information fixed right above. Finally, and perhaps most important of all, the results of many experiments fall into consistent patterns that make psychological sense. After reading the evidence presented in this chapter, your reader, one hopes, be in a position to attach before her own subjective probability to the validity of the ESP hypothesis. Your reader would be in an even better position, of course, if you want to consult the original report. In all likelihood, if the reader is open-minded, his probability will be greater than zero but less than one. Once one has decided upon one's own subjective probability, the important question then becomes whether that probability is high enough to justify assuming the existence of ESP as a working hypothesis or whether it takes further research. I have little sympathy for the kind of logic that says that if parapsychologists have failed to prove the existence of ESP after close to 100 years of research, further research is a waste of time. Progress is being made in this most difficult field of research, even though the progress is slow. Progress will be much faster if the educational and financial reports are available to the other side were equally available to parasites. I have